praise the Lord. And it sounds that if you believe and receive it, God will perform it today.
It was read from verses 4, 1 through 16.
But I'm going to lift up verse 14 for you again. And every different version of scripture is a good version and it relates to this particular one. But I like the word that comes out of the King James version, just for the first verse of King James Bible, for this fourth verse. It says, "For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise for the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. Who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this?" And that part again, this is, "For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then the deliverance will arise from some other place. Who knows why you came to the kingdom for such a time as this before?" This morning we're going to speak on the subject, I can't hold my peace. I can't hold my peace. Let us pray. Dear gracious and eternal God, we thank you for this day. We thank you, oh God, that you allowed us to assemble in this place, God. And God, I ask and pray on this morning that someone will not leave here the same way that they came, oh God, that they might hear your word, oh God, that they may hear the call to action and may go out, oh God, and do that what you called us to do, and that is to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, and to see about those who are in prison, God. We know that this ministry is not about us, oh God, but it is about the last, the lost, and the least, God. So give us whatever we need, oh God, in this place. So if someone came here today, God, looking for a financial blessing, oh God, we ask that you open up the windows of heaven and pull them out a blessing they won't have room enough to receive, God. If someone came today, God, and they're in the need of a healing, we know that you are the Lord, God, God, who healeth thee, God. Whatever they come from, God, whether it's a situation in their marriage, oh God, a situation on their job, a situation, oh God, with a friend, we know that you can mend all broken places and all broken relationships. Whatever the need, oh God, we know that if you can't do it, it can't be done. So God, come on in Antioch, gave me on this morning, God. Move by your power and hide thee, oh God, behind the cross, God, because I can't preach unless the preacher comes. So God, I thank you and I bless you and I acknowledge you because it's all about you. And you are the mighty King, the bread of heaven, the lily of the valley, and most of you are Mary's baby. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, 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 amen. For such a time as this, I can't hold my peace. And so I went back and forth of what I would call this particular sermon because I knew that it was Women's History Month. But as we conclude the celebration of this month, and you know, it's funny how Black History is 1 month in February and then women get 1 month in March, that we take time out to applaud women. But when you look at the history books of what women they want to applaud, you very rarely see Black women unless Black women are telling the story. And just think about all the accomplishments that Black women have made, women in general, Black women in particular around the world. Women who are unsung heroes, that are hidden figures in our community, who have kept us together generation through generation. But you might hear names of women such as in the women's suffrage movement, you hear about the white women, but you never said we hear about the Black women who stood on the line for women's suffrage, for the civil rights movement. Even today, women who work in the church, who work in the community, who work on the state level, internationally. And so it is only befitting that we're going to talk about some of those women today. Now, women's history did not just begin to be overshadowed. Today, it happened even back in biblical times, Pastor Simmons. You can look at the Bible. You can probably call out all the names of the women who were mentioned in the Bible. You can ask someone today, what women in the Bible do you know? And people would generally say things like Deborah, or Esther, or Mary, the mother of Jesus. They'll say Elizabeth, the mother of John the Baptist. They may say Mary and Martha, or they may say Sarah or Rebecca. And those are the names that you typically hear when people talk about women in the Bible, unless they want to throw some shade, and then they may say something about Bathsheba or Jezebel. But you know, women in general have not been mentioned in the Bible. And even when they have significant stories, they may be called the woman at the well, or the woman with the issue of blood, or the widow that had a widow of mine, or the woman, the widow who had all the people called. A lot of times women were not even given name in the Bible, because that showed what their work was like back then. And then we move into this generation. You hear about all the women who did great things in this country, like I mentioned before. You hear about all the Black men who did things for the civil rights movement, and then you have to go deep to try to hear something about a black woman. And we know that if it had not been for the black women, isn't this right, Hank, that there would be no black church. What would happen one day if all the black women did not come to church? What would happen? Who would the preacher be preaching to? Who would be putting money in the offering? Because if it went out for the women, all the churches would shut down. And not just the church. What would happen if black women just decided to just do nothing for not even a day, not stay at home for a day, stay at home for a week or a month? What would happen in our nation, in the world, if black women just went on strike? Could you imagine? See, this country was not only built on the backs of black slave men and women, but the black women who cooked the food for the slave master, the black women who nursed those babies, the black women who was out in the field. Black women have always been someplace doing something for everybody else. And when it came time to our families, we still had to take care of them too, which meant black women very seldom had time to take care of themselves. Even when it was the midst of things that would not be politically feasible for you to say something to, it was always a black woman who stood up and said something regardless of what the outcome may be, because she said something. Because black women learned something a long, long, long time ago, and that is something that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. once stated, is that silence is consent. See, silence is also betrayal. Because at the end of your life, you're not going to remember what your enemy said. You're going to remember that your friends, your family said nothing. So you've got to learn how to stand up and say stuff, even when it may not be comfortable for you. And the reason I'm saying this morning is we are living in very peculiar and complex times. I mean, it looks like from day to day that all hell is breaking loose. If you don't believe me, let's just go back to November 2016. We had a presidential election. So we already know for the past 8 years prior to that, that if many of us thought that we had arrived because a black man was in the White House, we were quickly told and quickly shown that racism is still alive, right? But we also learned something else in November 2016, that sexism on top of racism is alive. Because you had a qualified woman, more qualified than most of the people who've ever ran for president, and I know we can't be political AME, but this is Dee Dawkins-Haigler speaking this morning. Qualified woman running for president, and instead we chose an egomaniac, disco, psychotic president.
Now, I don't know what's going on over the King's
rest of her people if she don't do something. So what does Esther do? She realizes she's in a tight situation because that word's true to her. So she said, this is what we're going to do. I need you to go back. We're going to pray. Y'all going to fast. And we're going to get ourselves together. So I'm going to give y'all 3 points and I'm going to be loving. I'm going to sit myself on that. So we're going to go to the first one. The first one is you've got to say something. You can't hold your peace when you see situations going on around you. It's sad. It's not okay that our children don't have adequate education. It's not okay that they try to hold back health care for everybody. That stuff is not okay. It's really not okay that right now they're trying to do all this gerrymandering, map ringing, and for y'all who don't know what I'm talking about, right now the Georgia General Assembly, they just passed bills that they can change the district of where you vote because they don't like the way that it looks because our demographic are changing so much so that these seats now may go to people who are Democratic or look like us. And so what they've done is go with all this trickery, and that's what it is, it's trickery. And then a lot of us stay quiet because we feel like it does not affect us at the moment. Well, let me tell you, whatever they do today is going to affect all of us tomorrow. So you got to open up your mouth and say something. That's why I love when I go to, you know, you go to the little airport now and you see the little signs say, if you see something, say something. As black people, you know better. If you see something, you better say something. And I know, you know, my kids and that generation say, snitches get ditches. But let me tell you something. Now, the bill of that town tale, in this generation, this time, we better start telling, saying, marching, doing whatever we've got to do because they're trying to take us back. Some of y'all saying, take us back to where? I don't know where. Go ask them where they're trying to take us. Wherever they're trying to take us to, I'm not going. And I'm going to fight back myself. I'm going to fight back myself. So this is what black women have always done. They knew how to say something. You don't believe me? Let me call the road and show you how they always knew when and what to do if they were not afraid of their lives. So you can look, let's go back to someone like Harriet Tubman. See, Harriet Tubman, when she came out of slavery, she came from Maryland and made it. But when she got up there, she said, you know what? This is no good for me to be free by myself. Let me go risk my life and my liberty and my body and take myself back down and bring some other people back with me. This is something key. As we live, as we're lifting and climbing, we gotta bring other people with us. We can't be the rest of our people and let them stay because we done made it to the top. See, when we fail, when one fails, we all fail. We all are in this thing together. And we rise and fall together. Don't let the people fool you, trick you because you live in a nice house and drive a nice car, because they won't get you too. Look what they did to the president of the United States. Did they not try to show him that he was no more to them than a Negro? A color person, see, they're not taking us back. They're not even black no more. They're not trying to take us back to being all those other things that we try to arrive from. So, Harriet Tubman, what did she do? She was known as the biggest conductor, the greatest conductor of the Underground Railroad. She brought 300 slaves back from slavery. She took 19 trips, y'all don't hear me, 19 trips by herself with a gun. Let me tell you how she had that gun. See, some of y'all gotta be locked and loaded. For some of us, it might be the Bible. For some of us, we need a gun. Why? Because she had slaves, and they might be in the middle of the forest, the woods, the water. She tried to take you to slavery, and you said, I'm scared now. I want to go back. And she said, you're going to be free or you're going to die, but you're not going to kill the rest of us. That you playing around. See, now let me tell you something. I spent almost 9 years down in that Georgia General Assembly. And y'all put people in the office, you don't know what they're doing, what they're saying, who they're trading off with, what they voting for, because we have allowed other people to speak for us even when they don't have our best interest at heart. But we better be bold enough, bad enough to start calling, shifling, Negro out when they are appropriately representing us and say, you're going to have to United States. She didn't stop because she got her degree. She said, let us go and try to form organizations where we can go and help other black people. Then you had people like Fannie Lou Hamer who risked her life, who tried to get people registered to vote. And remember, y'all, she was a sharecropper. Her and her husband were sharecroppers. And because she tried to get black folk registered to vote, they kicked her off the plantation. They kicked her off so you could no longer sharecrop, took away everything that she had, and she still did not stop. She said, you know what? If I perish, let me perish. And that reminds me, if we perish, let us perish. But we've got to remember that many of us are on assignment by God. And if God put you on the assignment, God will take care of you. He won't bring you to it and not take you through it. You gotta understand, you've got to trust God in this thing. Now, is it easy? No, because me running my mouth got me not elected to the Senate. But that's okay. Let me tell you why it's okay. Because I'm just as dangerous on the outside as I was on the inside. See, if something was going to stop me, see, I said a lot down there, but I'm saying even more. Now, see, I don't have to account to anybody but God. And my people matter to me. And this does not mean that I'm racist, because I'm not. I love all people, but I especially love my people. And the problem we're having in America is we get offended or we get scared. People might say, oh, you're being racist. How can black people who do not control the wealth in a country be racist when we have not set the public policies? How do we become racist? The reason many of us are in the predicament we are in now is because people, presidents of the past, white people benefited off the back of slave labor for hundreds of years, and it takes time to catch back up. Black people are not shiftless and lazy. Stop letting people tell you this. Are you understanding? And young people, what's that song? It's a rapper. I don't know if that, but he said we started at the bottom, now we're here. Who, what rapper is that? Drake. But Drake don't know what he's talking about. We didn't start at the bottom, now we're here. We were Africa. We were kings and queens. We started at the top.
You got the Masonic order over here. You got the Link, the Boulay, you got the Jack and Jill, you got the
now. We feel if you're the person that want to march, put your shoes on and get to marching in those streets. If you're the person who want to boycott, keep your money, you know, if you have that kind of control, keep your money. Buy black, bank black, do whatever y'all got to do, but we have got to do it now. Because if we don't, things are going to happen to us. So if you kind of like put on a nice suit, you can put on a suit, go down to the Capitol and you lie to somebody. I mean, seriously, y'all. We can't all be the same, but we can all do something together. And so what I'm going to say, so the first thing I tell you is say something. Open up y'all mouth, y'all. Come on. You see something, say something. Number two, get on the same accord. Come on. Yeah. Do everything. And just remember that we are bold, bodacious people, especially black women. We know how to make a dollar out of 15 cents because our mothers and our grandmothers taught us that. They taught us that you got to still smile pretty, still be a wife, still take care of your children. And so much so that we've taken on this notion now that we better be the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker. But trust and believe, we still know how to do it with a smile because we know that our lives depend on it. So, but we need the black men to stand with us and help us. Now don't get twisted because you hear all this stuff about Martin Luther King and Abernathy and Andrew Young and Jesse Jackson. Yeah. They did a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing. They were great men. But every last one of them had a wife who was pushing the movement beside them. Every last one of them. The women, they weren't even called, but the women were keeping the movement going. The women were funding the movement. The women were not afraid. It would be other black leaders that were afraid to stand with those black men, but the women said, when, where, and how. They wouldn't be fair. They wouldn't look back. They wouldn't like, oh my God, what's going to happen to me and my job? They'd like, bring it on. And it means we got to walk to work with baskets on our head and our arms. When the bus driver, bus cop came around, then that's what they did. Well, they didn't need to ride a bus, but we'll do what we have to do. So now I'm telling y'all, do what you have to do. Teach our children that they have to do what they have to do. One thing the Jewish people always do, they remind their children of what they've been through. They tell them all the time. They put things around their necks and things around their houses so they remember what the Holocaust was like. And even before the Holocaust, what it was like to be persecuted as Jews. As black people, we try to run so far away from slavery. We don't have to run from it. It's a part of our history. It doesn't mean we stayed there. Slavery now is a state of mind. Some of y'all in slavery right now don't even realize it. I say who? I just said some. They may be here, they may not. But some people are still in slavery because their minds have shackles. But we got to take the shackles off because we have work to do. There's so much work to be done. We've got to be strong, continue to be resilient. We know that the White House was built on our backs, the Capitol was built on our backs, even though they wouldn't let us in the doors, all of that was done by black men and black women. And then the last thing I'm going to tell you, after you open up your mouth to say something, you know, you see something, you say something, and after you get on one accord, you have got to remember that God is in control. You know, Fannie Lou Hamer or Shirley Chisholm or Barbara Jordan or Sojourner Truth, all of these black women knew, whether it was Coretta Scott King or Juanita Abernathy or whether it was Michelle Obama, all of these women know that God is still in control. Because the enemy will try to mess with our minds and will try to tell us that if you do this, then you won't have a job. If you do this in corporate America, they may say something to you. If you do this, your children, you know, may not be able to get into the best school. But let me tell you something. If you don't do this, your grandchildren won't be able to do now what your children are doing. And so Esther, she had to warm it up. And so what did she do? Catch it out. Catch what she did. She once she got pulled on the carpet by the white guy, she said, this is what y'all gonna do. Y'all go back and you fast. And you pray. And then me and my handmaid are going to fast and we're going to pray. Because at the end of the day, she still knew that God was in control. And so no matter what's going on in your life, some situations you only going to get through them if you fast and you pray. And then you've got to believe that God is going to make a way when you fast and you pray. session just started. I don't have time for this. I got work to do. And she said, did you hear me? I said, yes, I heard you. She said, are you in shock? I said, no, I'm in shock. She said, well, there's no emotion on your face. That's what she said about Simmons. And I said, what type of emotion? She said, what are you thinking about? I said, baby, I had to stop and process for 1 minute. But I'm on the other side of this already.
Refreshing to hear a prophetic word.
Yes,
amen.